you got five or six lectures for one, and also what I'm going to try to do tonight is give you five or six views about how perhaps abstraction intersects with the public sphere in the space of one talk. The explosion of abstract art in early 20th century Europe in Russia is coded as avant-garde, a term that derives from military lingo. Indeed, these artists were waging war against dominant or oppositional ideologies, and they were willing to put themselves out there on the front lines, which is basically what avant-garde means, before the battalions, and to risk career or perhaps even literal suicide for circulating images that challenged so many assumptions about art. For instance, I could talk about the elemental spirituality of the Russian avant-garde, where pared-down forms, like in this painting by Malevich, were stark counterpoints to prevailing traditional aesthetics and ethics. Or we could look at speedy vectors and explosive warfare signaled in the graphics of Italian futurism, which signaled support for hyper-reliance on technology, as in this book page by Marinetti, especially in the form of efficient and fascistic machines. Closer to home, and most interesting to me at our current political moment, is the story of the CIA working with the Museum of Modern Art in the 1950s to create traveling exhibitions of abstract expressionist painting. The Congress of Cultural Freedom was formed in 1950, and it worked through the also newly formed International Organizations Division, these are all parts of the CIA, to become an official sponsor of traveling exhibitions, exporting American art to major museums in Europe. And the hope was that during the Cold War, this uniquely homegrown form of robust painterly energy would proclaim a cultural power that would be perceived as political dominance, especially by Russia. That's definitely using abstraction as a tool in ideological conflicts. But this trajectory wouldn't address the question of how the artworks are made, or what they're made from, or why. So an alternative history of abstraction in the public sphere could examine the cultural materials from which the abstractions are assembled. If the public sphere is made of discourse, and if discourse is any symbolic system, I'm thinking of Roland Barthes' idea of the fashion system to suggest that the clothes we wear can be said to encode trends which could be analyzed like a language. Why not a history of modernist and postmodernist collage? Such a history could range from cubist snippets of newspapers to John Chamberlain's car sculptures, and then the light bulb installations of Dan Flavin, those of Sarah Quinn Evans. These examples show collage to be happening on both sides of the Atlantic. Collage nimbly takes up political issues, such as the 1960s women's movement getting refracted through the femage quilt-like objects. Instead of collage, she wanted these to be called femage objects of Judy Pfaff. The more contemporary issues of African-American representation encoded in the collages Lorna Simpson. The installations of Sarah Zee, who represented the U.S. in the last Venice Biennale in 2013, actually it was a couple ago, are made from an array of products and tidbits which open a window onto our contemporary political or public sphere by surveying a wide range of cultural products, from photographs of vistas to snippets of product labels and bottle tops. Right now, at the Venice Biennale, artist Mark Bradford, oh, that's not a good image, it's an overview. Here's a close-up of his collage technique, and I'm a huge fan of his. Right now, he has an installation in Venice made from the cell phone ads that are postered around his South LA neighborhood, blending a contemporary local quality with something more formal and in the history of painting. But it's also an additional question of how abstract art intersects with the public sphere, because he's using State Department funding to call into question some of the State Department policies that are putting his neighbors in jail while then advertising to them to buy cell phones they can't afford so that they can communicate from those jail cells. So he's basically putting a lot of things in dialogue that conflict with each other in a complicated way. But speaking of newspapers, that Cubist strategy of pasting pieces of the daily paper into artwork could be seen as kicking off an entire century of abstract collage referring to politics simply by using the newspaper. And I'm thinking of the collage paintings of Jasper Johns, the enormous collage painting of Agnes Martin's lesser-known friend, Krissa, and this is a sad snapshot of an enormous painting owned by the Guggenheim, but it establishes their aesthetic connection as well as their social connection. Then there's Fred Tomaselli's recent abstractions on the front pages of the New York Times, and several artists who block out even more of the newspaper, such as Joseph Ernst in his project Nothing in the News. This, I think, is marketed as a moment of zen in the face of the daily barrage, so I read this as a sort of fruitless wish for a blissful escapism. Pat Shannon's installations of New York Times pages with all the readable bits cut out strikes me as more trenchant. It makes me think of the fragility of the social order and the way that circulating news adds stability to the community, just when we all share a discourse in common. And here are my own redactions of newspaper pages. These are articles about Agnes Martin's death, which become geometric abstractions, echoing her aesthetic while diverging from her hyper-regular geometries, as well as her studied avoidance of newspapers. These are political, also, in the sense that they suggest the difficulty of summing up any human life, or maybe even any news item, in just a few columns. Some aspects of reality can perhaps be better conveyed through wordless forms or gestures. These latter projects, the three with all minimalist aesthetics, could all be objecting to the oversaturating glut of information that now defines our public sphere. Or they're making an object out of it, solidifying and simplifying it, making it manageable. This gets closer to the territory that I'm really here to talk about. But first, we'll make one more stop to examine a strategy that brings together this formalist distillation with the more overtly ideological concerns that started us off. In the recent history of abstraction, several artists have used reductive aesthetics to address political issues. So Richard Serra's Tilted Arc, this tall wall, was created in 1981 for the plaza in front of New York's Jacob Javits Federal Building. And its modernist abstract forms, as well as its blockage of lunch eaters' usual views, caused controversies. And they turned into contentious court cases about whether abstraction was inherently about the implied content or about aesthetic pleasure. These aren't altogether aiming at meaning or beauty. And who would set these standards? Who would interpret the project's meaning or its aesthetic value? Now, this case was resolved by resorting to the fundamental variable of human survival. It was argued that the sculpture was removed, needed to be removed, and it was removed in 1989 because it would block firefighters' access to the building in case of emergency. And another project to give form to a political situation, Maya Lin's Vietnam Veterans Memorial, finished in 1982, was selected in a blind competition because its sharp geometry, a violent cut into the earth, expressed the searing pain of that episode in our country's history. Yet its polished black marble walls also allowed for a kind of nobility and dignity in the face of that pain. More recently, The 9/11 Memorial Museum in New York City opened in 2014 with a monumentally fragile project by artist Spencer Finch. And this inscription says, "No day shall erase you from the memory of time." It's a quotation from Virgil. But his piece is called "Trying to Remember the Color of the Sky on That September Morning." Spencer Finch often creates installations based on color samplings from specific sites. And for this piece, Finch painted 2,983 squares of paper in blue watercolor. Each page a different mix of pigments, and each trying to remember and to represent the exact color blue of the sky on that incongruously sunny day. So these projects channel responses to overtly political circumstances, and they channel them into pared-down, sensible forms. I hope they've paved the way toward a more indirect way of translating politics into visual form. I want to imagine abstraction as a response that emerges when language fails. If the public sphere is defined by political, social, and/or commercial discourse, then it has something to do with language. But abstraction is decidedly non-linguistic, even if it has structure in grids or systems, layout templates or hardware designs that would lead us into language-like mental activity. So what does it mean to say that abstraction speaks in non-linguistic modes? Well, let's head back to Agnes Martin. She believes that language and art were incompatible. Part of the reason that she wanted artists not to read the newspaper was so that the clutter and detail of words would not interfere with the sensibility. Though her visual strategies were minimalistic, she wanted to be known as not as a minimalist, but as an abstract expressionist. She was trying to work with subtle feelings, like the expressionists, instead of with intellectual systems, like the minimalists. Her structures for containing these subtle feelings in the 1960s, when these paintings were being made and hitting their stride, could be seen as a type of political response, offering a quiet steadiness and an enduring consistency, just as the country was going through not so subtle political changes and conflicts. While her work is often seen as a personal struggle with maintaining composure in the face of inner agitation, one commentator from Tate Modern writes that, quote, "The modernist grid in its very structure is an opponent of mental and visual disorientation," perhaps even related to Martin's diagnosed schizophrenia. These conditions could easily be seen as social and not just psychological. And there were psychiatrists at that time, I'm thinking of Artie Lang, who were talking about schizophrenia as actually a sensible response to a nonsensical political moment. This framework also explains a fascinating response to another more famous abstract expressionist, Jackson Pollock. Last month, I listened to an educational video that had just been posted about this painting, and it alluded to the common critique that I've heard so many times about this kind of painting. But anyone can do that, which is only a slightly coded version of, "My five-year-old could do that." The video only justifies the painting on technical grounds, saying that Pollock's drip technique was in fact hard won. It points out some visual structuring devices, etc. But I would like for you to hear another view. And I'm going to link to this interview that Studs Terkel did with Zero Mostel in 1961. This is a time when contemporary art was apparently a topic for general daily conversation. And I didn't expect that Studs Terkel was going to suddenly ask Zero Mostel, who I'm familiar with mostly because he played Tevye in Fiddler on the Roof, to suddenly start talking about Jackson Pollock. It's almost like he's saying, "How about those Mets?" It's like, "How about that action painting?" So I want to play you this excerpt.
It's colorful, deep, mysterious. You have to take 5 dictionaries, 9 languages, and sit down and read. Actually, what you do with the hallucinations, a word or a gesture.
Sorry, this was queued up before.
And yet somehow, I have a feeling that Zero Mostel, the artist on the stage, is this way. Not only because you're a good actor and a good comedian, a good clown, a good burlesque comic.
But a good son.
And a good son.
Father.
And
a good mother. A good sister and a good brother.
Aren't you going to hear them?
Don't clap your hands.
There's something else about here, too. That's you, in painting, the artist. Is there a question that comes up? We speak of lack of communication of our day. And we speak of non-objective painting today and action painting. What's your feeling? What do you feel is authentic and what do you feel is false about? This is a general question. Just want to get your
If you want a general answer.
No, I want a specific answer.
Well, you ask me a general question, then you want a specific answer. You are crazy, my friend. You are deeply crazy. Rephrase the question, otherwise I don't even attempt to answer. Study.
Your feelings about trends in painting.
First of all, how I feel about a paint.
About a paint.
It's just so, you know, this whole thing about, well, what is he doing, or what does it mean, or what is it for our time? Who is to tell us what is for our times? Too many painters painted for their times, and no one knew it. And it was only later that we found out. I'm just fascinated by the wonderful things that the human hand and mind do. As soon as it's done by hand and the mind, I accept it. And then I hope to have the tolerance to sit through it and maybe find something out about it. The action painters have something. They reflect something. Jackson Pollock's drips reflect something of our time. The worthlessness of it, maybe. Of a certain section of it. There is something about it that's so. What's his name? The wonderful art critic, John Berger, the English art critic, said, he gave a wonderful picture of Jackson Pollock. And he said, he paints as if he would never had any communication in the world. He lived in a cell, and there happened to be paint there, and this is how he expressed himself since there was no language. Now, we live in a nut house. A large section of our thinking is nutty. And he reflects it. There is something about it. The busyness that we always get ourselves involved with, which would produce nothing at all, it's reflected in his painting. It is a reflection of our time. And it's done by hand, and it's done with imagination. So I like to sit through it. So, also, I always distrust the man who says, that's what I like. I don't, it may be art, but I don't like it. I know too many people who go into a room full of Rembrandts and say, I don't like it. Well, he's a fathead. He doesn't dig it.
Instead of saying, I don't dig it, he says, I don't like it.
I don't like it.
He says, I know what I like.
I like it. You know, the like King Ego walks in, and he used to tell you what the painter is. The mere fact that art is from the hand and mind and eye is a remarkable thing. And therefore, I will sit through it and I'll try to find out something about it. I hope that puts you in your place.
That in itself is sufficient. From the hand and mind. And so you will sit through it. In other words, if you sit through it.
That doesn't say it might be rotten after I sit through it. But you know, our conception of art is based on a little sampling of it. It's never based on a huge knowledge of it. Oh, excuse me, the cigarette just...
This is a visual gag, the audience missed the point. The cigarette flew out of Mr. Mostel's mouth.
Across the road and almost killed the proprietors of the station. What was I?
About the matter of...
Why was I there?
Why were you there?
Hey, where am I going? See, waiting for Godot. And what are we doing here? Waiting for what? Waiting for this to be over. This will never be over. Oh, waiting for Godot.
This is connected to something you said earlier. We live in a nut house, you said.
But I don't think there is a part of our house that's terribly nutty.
It's a big part.
When you read all the literature about atomic energy, and you still read about the missile race, that's nutty. When anybody thinks there can be any warlike uses of missiles, it's nutty. It's crazy. The building of shelters, protect us from what? We're doomed if it's drugged. See, we're in a nut house. We're in Pollock's little shelter when we're going to go down there and hide from something.
Jackson Pollock makes sense there.
Yes, he does.
But I mean, he couldn't have painted
Jackson
this.
Jackson Pollock, and nobody's nudging my shoulders, a great artist. And de Kooning is a great artist.
But he couldn't have painted this, could he? He couldn't have done this work in the time of the Flemish, could he? I mean, could he?
I see a parallel between the work of Bosch and Bruegel and Pollock. I see an almost natural development. I see it develop down to Enzo and to Pollock. It's so, they reflected the nut house.
Could you expand this more?
Well, you have to know the Bosch paintings, like the Garden of Delights, you know, it's feelings of hell, of religious fanaticism. Bruegel's painting of the Flemish proverbs, Enzo's paintings of medicine and doctors and quacks.
And so why is it?
And although it's more representational, that doesn't make it better. It still reflects. It's still by the hand and the eye, you know.
So they, the hand and the eye in that time,
yeah,
reflected nut houses of that time, perhaps.
Of course. And another marvelous thing is we don't know what these people looked like. You see a Rembrandt portrait. What we're attracted to is not the remarkable likeness of the 50 extant Rembrandt self-portraits. He looks quite different in every one of them. So there's a quality other than that that's wonderful. And that is because it's done a certain way, and it's done with a great honesty. What was I saying? I don't know what I'm saying.
I like this for a lot of reasons.
Yeah.
One of them is that it creates a clear and approachable commentary and finds sense in all its nonsense, seeming nonsense. Of course, Mostel can see that because in the tradition of the wise fool, he's the clown who tells the truth. Also, this sense packs a powerful political punch. But I also appreciate that last conclusion that we just heard, where he kind of shrugs his shoulders and laughs. Because what I get from this is he's just admitting that he's one person standing in front of this work and saying what meaning he's creating for himself. And I think that's exactly our challenge. We each need to stand in front of these works and derive our own sense out of them based on individual responses to their manifest visual forms. The viewer's responsibility is to exercise sensible intelligence in real time. So, I'll try to demonstrate this with reference to another artist from this time. Rothko, who was born Marcus Rothkowitz in Russia and came to the U.S. to escape the political dangers for Jews in his homeland, is known as the primary color field painter, creating large canvases. And these areas, like Martin's, these fields, digested political insanity into structures that, while seeming simple, actually teemed with electric energy. While Martin dealt in subtle undercurrents of feeling, Rothko radiated waves of feeling. His color fields overwhelm the sensibility by filling the field of perception. Oops, that's not a Rothko. And inviting you to swim around in layers of liquid on the canvas. We could go back to that one. Each layer was thin and sheer, so the cumulative effect was of trapped light, or of light slowly releasing. And this feels like a determined, stubborn, existential effort to maintain a kind of hope in the aftermath of World War II. After the Shoah, Hiroshima, and Nagasaki had shown us human beings to be capable of being more cruel to each other and more massively destructive than we had ever imagined. But there's a danger in confusing this kind of expressionism with more recent paintings that have been called zombie abstraction. Over the past few years, critics have been worrying over a trend in abstract painting in which young artists especially flood the market with paintings that seem tossed off, not really considered in technical craft or in manifest content, or made from materials that just sort of trumpet in their trickery, in a sense. And I don't want to say that it's visually tricky, it's more like, oh, I'm using this material in this way that is going to be trendy. And their motivation seems driven by a quick profit and or by a wish to gain a reputation through sales, getting a splash of attention from a splash of paint. It's seen either as a cynical move or as a pragmatic admission that the market has overwhelmed all other dimensions of the art world. It's also equating the interior decoration industry for hotel chains with the phenomenon of art dealer sharks who flip product, that is paintings, by selling gullible collectors on the investment prospects of a young artist who promises to develop a career. For the sale to go through, it doesn't really matter if that artist displays intelligence, wit, mastery, or the potential for developing any of these. And so, how can this type of painting be distinguished from the alternative impulse I'm describing? When it comes to abstraction, the answer is again in the way you respond to the details of a given work. You, as an individual viewer, must try to detect the signs of intelligent life in the universe. For example, when I look at Elizabeth Burleigh's work, I see that paintings like these hold open a space that feels generous and not empty. Paintings like these attend to energies that activate and harmonize undercurrents of delight. That light is sort of continuing from Rothko, and it also to talk about delight sort of makes me think of when my dad used to talk about the agony of defeat in reference to the wide world of ABC's wide world of sports. There's we need to have delight in both senses. So no matter how destabilizing and unsettling the times, we have a choice about the mood in which we move forward. And no matter what her actual day-to-day doubts or anxieties, Burleigh chooses to present these uplifted possibilities. Another example of sensible complexity is encoded in the paintings of Trudy Benson, and that painting looked, or that image looked better on the small screen. She juxtaposes forms on several layers using diverse visual languages and media. And isn't this a good metaphor for having a lot of screens up on your laptop at once? Mm-hmm. And while again these images seem to be responding to the unsettled agitation of our times, they also provide some kind of visual structure which has a good sense of humor. And Julie Moretti, by contrast, exposes an underbelly of chaos in the urban social fabric. In monumental paintings that mix her architectural interests with her interests in economic systems. These visual structures make me aware of how difficult it is to think globally, to fathom, much less analyze, the functioning of socioeconomic systems. Abstraction can take form in space as well as on the wall. I'm thinking of the perceptual trickery of James Turrell, whose architecturally rejiggered rooms and open-roofed sky spaces call into question the basics of what's where and what's what. While these installations could be seen as entertaining crowd pleasers where lighting is designed to have an ooh-ah effect, I'd like to consider them as live-in examples instead of virtual reality. They're like holodecks, as in Star Trek The Next Generation, but the alternative world we're visiting in these works is actually our own. And the work of the artwork is to fine-tune our senses. So instead of being politically escapist, I'd rather think of these works as attuning us to the more fundamental realities, whether it's microscopic human perception or macroscopic atmospheric conditions, which contain and condition all of the daily and no less fundamental details that fall between these scales. Terrell offers a sense of perspective as well as reference points for how to weigh things. Now, I wish to end this consideration with the paintings of A.R. Pink. Not an altogether contemporary artist, but the news of his death in Zurich is circulating today. Born in 1939 as Ralph Winkler in East Germany, he remained there until 1961, when he was driven into exile. From what I've been able to figure out, his so-called crime, that's not him, but that's one of his paintings. Here's his painting. His so-called crime was simply expressing solidarity with people who were being targeted for persecution. And the artwork that interests me here are these abstract paintings which combine the energy of Pollock's drips with the complex spatial folding of the cubists, and the linguistic scramble that characterizes our moment. So in other words, he's bringing language back in. We'll get to that in a sec. How do we interpret the swirl of discourse that is our reality? An obituary printed in Art Forum quotes from a 1988 article in that same magazine in which Wolfgang Faust wrote, "At the core of Pank's art is a yearning for a universal human sign language. The system paintings, as the artist calls them, transmit signals and information concerning social as well as historical conditions. The goal of these works, however, is not a mere depiction of reality. Instead, Pink aims to transform the world through them." He shows little line men and pictorial symbols aligned, arranged in highly readable scenes and referring to war, oppression, and dependency, but also to love, friendship, and solidarity. That's the end of the quotation. So, Pink wanted his paintings to change the world. Certainly an attempt to penetrate the public sphere. And instead of avoiding or transmuting language, he engages with it. But what strikes me about his work is how far back he went in the history of pictorial imagery to press forward. His stick figures recall cave art and children's doodles. Remember how fervently our abstractionist from the beginning, Picasso, wanted to draw like a child. And some of that large painting reminds me of a combination of Guernica and Keith Haring's murals. And speaking of going all the way back to cave art, if you want to come back to this room at 4:30 tomorrow, we'll be watching Werner Herzog's Cave of Forgotten Dreams. Welcome, there will be popcorn. But what are Pank's figures actually doing? It's not clear. It's not as clear as in either Guernica or, this is not a good example of Keith Haring's figurative work, although we do see a couple of figures in there. Some are more specific about what the figures are doing. But what about Pank's? What do these paintings say to us then? In this 2005 painting, City of Memories, primary colors plus black and white combine with alphabetic and pictorial signs to create a field divided into angular shapes. These divisions, Alex Greenberger suggests in yesterday's obituary in Art News, express, quote, a universal language, one that could address the trauma, sadness, and loss that followed World War II, but that would also affect viewers beyond Germany. But I don't see any simple depiction of trauma or sadness or loss here. If there's trauma, it's from the pain of having a reality fractured. There looks to be nothing restful about living in the world of this painting. But that fracturing also releases enormous energy, which is to say, enormous potential. Like the splitting of the atom, the energy release can be used for bombs or for nightlights. And of course, the problem with atomic energy for nightlights is that the fission can end up being just as dangerously deadly as the bombs. So the challenge posed by Pink's painting is in how to stay on the generative side of this fracturing. And that's where I see the color palette coming in handy. While Greenberger talks about the sadness and loss, I feel that Pink is asking viewers to move forward with also an uplifted energy, despite whatever sadness and loss is suffered in the wake of a fractured social order. And in fact, he assembles all the pieces into an electric bracing whole, a field in which we can play, even as our perception is pierced by the sharp angles and contrasting colors. In this play, I would hope, we can imagine new possibilities for ways forward, forge newly configured common grounds, and structure these on the principle of social delight. And again, there's that delight, instead of on social destruction or societal destruction. So I realize in cataloging these roads not taken, I've done what Patty Larkin does in her song, The Book I'm Not Reading, which is tell you about all the different arrays of abstraction in relation to the public sphere that I've been thinking about. This is by design because I haven't been sure that there's already a conversation about abstraction here, so I wanted to open up a bunch of different possibilities, but since you actually are the public, I would really be interested in knowing how all of these ideas about abstraction speak to you.